We can start right now. So the stage is yours.
Thank you. I'm going to be talking about MiddlePolice. This is work led by my graduate student, Zhuotao Liu, and another graduate student at Illinois, Hao Jin, and our collaborator, Michael Bailey. So the goal of this work is to fix the problem of volumetric DDoS attacks in the internet. Distributed denial of service is a big problem, and we've seen a number of distributed denial of service attacks recently. It turns out that a large fraction of these attacks are volumetric. So in particular, over 65% of DDoS attacks are volumetric. The way a volumetric DDoS attack works is that the attackers send a large volume of traffic to the victim such that it overwhelms the victim's connection to its ISP, causing a high rate of packet loss on the links between the ISP and the victim. The commercial solution to this problem has been distributed denial of service protection as a service, some kind of cloud service like Akamai or Cloudflare. The way that these systems work is that the victim uses DNS or BGP to redirect traffic that's originally destined for the victim to some intermediate cloud server up here. The cloud servers then use proprietary algorithms to scrub the traffic that the cloud service believes to be denial of service traffic and passes the scrub traffic along to the victim. Now, one possible problem is that the attackers might be able to bypass the cloud directly, bypass the cloud and directly send the traffic to the victim. So the strengths of this approach are that it's immediately deployable. There's no need for any core internet modification. And it's scalable to large attacks. So Brian Krebs's blog was recently under a 620 gigabit per second attack. And his cloud server was able to take that amount of bandwidth, although it would have charged him quite a hefty price. The limitations of this approach, though, are that the traffic policing algorithms are proprietary. So that means that the victim cannot select its own scheduling policy. Also, the adversary, if they know the real IP address of the victim, can bypass the cloud infrastructure and directly send traffic to the victim, thus overwhelming that link between the victim and its ISP. There's been extensive work in the past also that uses network capabilities. So the strength of this approach is that the source needs explicit permission, that is, a capability, in order to send traffic to the victim. There are several limitations to the network capability-based approach, though. First, these approaches are hard to deploy in the internet. They often require deployment from unrelated ASs, that is, not the victim and not the victim's ISP. And they also often require client modification, which is hard to convince vendors to do, especially if the vendor is a Internet of Things box that has proprietary software. Often these approaches are not destination driven. The defense protocol, rather than the victim, determines the policy. So for example, if you have a capability system that provides per computation fairness or per source AS fairness, those fairness mechanisms are ones that are determined by the protocol, not determined by the victim. So these existing capability schemes impose strong deployment requirements. They require deployment in a large number of places, but they actually give you relatively weak properties in terms of the fairness conditions that you can enforce. So MiddlePolice is a hybrid approach. It combines the cloud-based approach by doing all of our enforcement in the cloud, or almost all of our enforcement in the cloud, together with a capability-based system that allows us to make sure that the paths are actually able to support the traffic that's being offered. And we get MiddlePolice, which has both of these desirable properties of being deployable and scalable, having the destination provide permission to traffic, but it also has the property that we can have completely destination-driven policies. So a destination can decide what types of policies are most appropriate for traffic that is reaching that destination. In order to accomplish this, we also develop an effective mechanism for filtering bypass traffic. MiddlePolice moves all of the capability deployment requirements into the well-provisioned cloud so that it can be immediately deployable. And it also enforces a victim-selectable policy. So the victim can choose whatever policy that it wants as long as it's computable. And that policy then is enforced inside the cloud. We also design an immediately deployable packet filtering mechanism that discards almost all of the traffic that bypasses the cloud. Our architecture looks quite similar to the architecture of the cloud-based filtering approaches. So we've got a set of middle boxes that are in the cloud. Each middle box polices the traffic based on victim-defined policies, and it uses a capability feedback loop in order to ensure that the path is capable of handling the traffic that the middle box delivers. One change here compared to the traditional cloud scheme is that we employ a packet filter inside of the ISPs or somewhere upstream of the victim that is able to handle bypass attacks. And this packet filter discards almost all of the traffic that tries to bypass the middle box. So there are two main challenges to designing this approach. The first is that we need the middle box to have some way of estimating the downstream capacity without remote deployment. So ordinarily in capability-based schemes, you deploy the capability scheme right on the link that is the bottleneck, because you have to deploy the capability scheme everywhere. So the capability scheme has a direct view of the bottleneck link. Here, we're deploying our middle box potentially far away from the bottleneck link, and we don't even know which one of these links is going to be the bottleneck. Also, we need to know the capacity or the available capacity of the congested link. The reason why we need to know this precisely is that when we have an overestimate, that's going to cause the middle box to allow a large amount of traffic to pass to this link, which is going to cause further congestion and packet loss downstream. However, if we underestimate the capacity of this congested link, then the middle box is going to throttle traffic that is going through that link, because what we want to do is we want to make sure that we don't induce congestion. And by doing that, we're going to waste downstream capacity if we cannot fix our underestimates of the capacity of this link. The second challenge is to design a readily deployable filtering mechanism to discard bypass traffic. Prior work has shown that it's quite easy for an attacker to get access to the real IP address of the victim. And so we need some filtering mechanism that's deployable on commodity routers so that we don't have to require some refit of the ISP's infrastructure in order to support this. So we use capabilities in a pretty traditional manner for path capacity verification. The main difference is that we evaluate the entire downstream path rather than one link at a time. We use cryptographic capabilities that are inserted by the middle box so that it cannot be spoofed by intermediate nodes or the victim. And the victim has a capability handling module that returns these capabilities to the middle box. So when the client sends a packet to the middle box for forwarding, the middle box stamps that packet with a capability, sends the packet onto the victim. If the packet reaches the victim, then the capability handling module removes the capability from the packet, delivers the remaining part of the packet to the application, and in response to the ACK, puts the capability back in the acknowledgement packet. The acknowledgement packet is returned through the middle box, and the middle box takes this capability and processes it so that it knows the fraction of packets that actually made it to the victim compared to the fraction of packets that are lost, and it passes this acknowledgement packet back to the client. So as you can see, from a client and an application perspective, MiddlePolice is completely transparent. All of the work is done by the middle box and the capability handling module. In order to do this, the middle box needs to keep some state. So on a per sender basis, the middle box will keep track of the number of packets that it's received so that it can police the bandwidth that's allocated to the sender. It needs to keep track of the number of packets which are lost both for estimation of the state of the link and also estimation of how good this flow is, and we'll talk about that momentarily. Plus, it has some state to manage and track capabilities so that every packet that it passes along is stamped with a unique capability. One of the things that these metrics are used to measure is a long-term packet loss rate. And this long-term packet loss rate is averaged over a few seconds. The idea of this long-term packet loss rate is to determine whether or not this sender is reactive. That is, whether this sender sends less traffic when it experiences congestion. Well-behaved flows are considered to be, reactive flows are considered to be well-behaved flows. And if you send a lower traffic rate when the loss rate is higher, then that means that your long-term loss rate will be lower than the time average loss rate of the path. Conversely, if you don't react to loss, then your loss rate will be equal to the time average loss rate of the path. And finally, if you perform one of these attacks like the Shrew attack that tries to coordinate all of the attack traffics at the same time to cause losses, then the long-term loss rate of such a flow is going to be higher than the time average loss rate. So just this long-term loss rate allows us to know how responsive this sender is, and that's going to be used for making one of our forwarding decisions later. This per sender state is refreshed periodically so that this loss rate can be computed over the last few seconds. Now, once we have all of the state from these senders, we can compute the available capacity on the downstream path. In particular, what we do is we just sum the delivered packets over all of the flows. And what that gives us is the amount of bandwidth that the path is currently delivering for us. Now, that means that this number will never be overestimated because we're computing this capacity based on the traffic that's actually being delivered. Finally, we have this victim-specified bandwidth allocation decision. The victim specifies a function to apply to the total capacity that gives us the bandwidth that we're going to allow for a particular sender. So we have a mechanism that gets a capacity for the downstream link, and we know that that capacity is not an overestimate because it is the amount of capacity that the link is actually handling. So the next question is, how do we avoid underestimates? So what we do is we divide each sender's traffic into privileged packets and best effort packets. So each sender's privileged traffic share depends on the sender's victim-selected fair share. And we accept a sender's best effort traffic only if two conditions hold. First, the downstream path needs to have a low short-term loss rate. That means that from our experience, the downstream path is not congested. And second, the sender's long-term loss rate is also below a threshold. That is, we believe that the sender is a responsive protocol, and so it's going to use the bandwidth that it's given responsibly. So in short, what we do when we receive a packet is we look it up in the state to figure out which flow it's associated with. If it's privileged or best effort. If it's best effort, we apply the two loss rate rules, a short-term loss rate rule to make sure that the path is uncongested, and a long-term loss rate rule to make sure that the flow is benign. And if the best effort packet meets both of these loss rate rules, then it's accepted. Otherwise, we discard this packet. All privileged packets are always accepted. And once we accept a packet, we perform capability handling on that packet. So we stamp a unique capability on it, and we track this packet to see whether or not it was successfully delivered. We then send this packet out to the output port. Now, the second challenge was that we need to be able to throttle bypassing traffic. MiddlePolice is only able to police traffic that traverses the middle box. This is because we don't require deployment at the routers. Now, MiddlePolice is agnostic to the type of bypass traffic filter that's implemented. So if you have another bypass traffic throttle mechanism that you prefer, it can drop straight into MiddlePolice. But we do propose this mechanism that's immediately deployable. And what we do is we encapsulate all of the traffic from the middle box to the victim with a UDP header. Now, that UDP header has a 16-bit source port and a 16-bit destination port. And so we simply generate a 32-bit secret that's shared between the victim and the middle box. And we use access control lists on commodity routers to filter on this secret. The only requirement is that the filter has to be deployed before the bottleneck link along every single path that the attacker might use. And what this is able to do is it's able to reduce the, if the attacker tries to randomly guess the source and destination ports, its impact is reduced by a factor of 4 billion, which reduces very large distributed denial of service attacks to relatively small and manageable traffic flows. Another thing that MiddlePolice needs is some method to validate a source. MiddlePolice can use any method to validate a source, but it needs to know who the source is because it needs to be able to track this concept of whether the flow is well behaved or not, whether or not the flow is reactive. So our mechanism is pretty similar to the TCP handshake, except that we can carry a lot more entropy. We rely on HTTP or HTTPS's redirect mechanism. As a result, it's completely transparent to clients. There's quite a bit more entropy than the TCP handshake. In fact, we can put as much entropy in as we want. And what this can ensure then is that the sender is on path. So that means that an attacker cannot spoof an IP address unless it is on the path between the middle box and the spoofed IP address. We implemented MiddlePolice, the middle box functionality, as well as the capability handling, using the NetFilter Linux kernel module. NetFilter is convenient here because it allows manipulation of the kernel data structure that's used for storing packets. Our implementation required no changes to the client and no internet upgrades. Our evaluation then is in three parts. First, we did an internet evaluation to study the path length and latency inflations that are caused by our rerouting through the cloud. Now, these are basically exclusively attributable to the fact that we're using the cloud. So if you use Cloudflare or Akamai today, you suffer the same level of latency inflation. The second thing that we did is a private testbed experimental evaluation. And this showed the overhead of traffic policing, the effectiveness of our bypass filter, as well as the effectiveness of enforcing our victim-chosen policies. Finally, we did a large-scale simulation evaluation where we studied some system parameters and made sure that this approach scaled. So I'm going to present some results from the first two of those experiments today. To study path length inflation, what we did is we did this at the AS level because that was the level at which we can most easily regenerate an internet topology. We reconstructed the AS level internet topology. We assumed that the cloud the middle boxes were hosted in the Amazon EC2 cloud. And then we constructed the direct path and the rerouted path between many source AS and victim AS pairs. We divided the victim's ASs up into non-stub ASs and stub ASs, so stub ASs being those that have only providers and no customers. Among non-stub ASs, the average path inflation was 1.1 AS hops, and we actually were able to find a shortcut in 10% of the cases, and in 22% of the cases, there was no AS hop inflation at all. In the case of stub ASs, we had an average path inflation of 1.5 hops with about 16.5% of the flows either experiencing a shorter number of AS hops or no inflation. Overall, there's a path inflation of 1.3 AS hops and almost 30% of paths experienced either a shortcut or no AS hop length inflation. We also wanted to explore the latency of using this cloud service. So we deployed some middle boxes on EC2 in America, Asia, and Europe. We had one server, and we had over 100 senders that were globally distributed. Each sender posted a 100 kilobyte file to a server, and that server was located either on a home internet connection or at a university. And we measured the latency through both the direct path and the rerouted path through one of these Amazon EC2 middle boxes. We found that for this particular file size, the average latency increased by about 9% for the entire transfer time. And this is the cumulative distribution function of those latencies. For the testbed, we had a total of 10 sending ASs and one victim AS. Every AS had a 1 gigabit connection. So the bottleneck link then is this 1 gigabit connection to the victim. Three of our ASs, attack ASs, attacked through the middle box. Six of the attack ASs tried to bypass the middle box entirely. So bypassing the middle box entirely doesn't work very well with our filtering mechanism. These six attack ASs then can send a total of 6 gigabits of UDP traffic. 6 gigabits divided by 4 billion is about 1.5 bit per second. So about 1.5 bits per second made it through, through our filter. Also, even if the attacker somehow is able to figure out this 32-bit secret, and there's some fairly clever tricks that the attacker could do to try to figure this out, but even if the attacker figures it out, what happens is that the key is stolen, suddenly we get 1 gigabit of bypassing traffic, and then we have a mechanism for updating the key, and once the keys are all updated and the ACL is reconfigured, then again this amount of traffic drops back down to 1 gigabit per second. Sorry, to 1.5 bits per second. We evaluated enforcing victim-defined policies. I'm going to pick two of the victim-defined policies. We looked at per AS fair share, so we fairly allocated the downstream capacity among all ASs. Now, this is not a mechanism that you'd actually use in practice because some ASs are large and some ASs are small, but it reflects the ability of the victim to select a policy and enforce it. We also looked at bandwidth reservation for premium ASs. So in certain environments, you might know that certain customers are premium customers, and so you want to make sure that they always have access to the channel. We looked at two different attack strategies, the flat rate attacks, which are non-adaptive. They send a flat rate of traffic, and reactive attacks, where the senders are sending TCP traffic, but what they do is they actually send 300 times as many flows as the legitimate nodes. So that if we just used a normal TCP fair environment, the attackers would get 300 times as much bandwidth as the legitimate AS. So here's our per AS fair share. The graph on the left is the normalized window size on the y-axis and the simulated time on the x-axis. So this tells us how much bandwidth is being allowed through per AS. And what we see is that the legitimate AS actually has a slight advantage over the attacking ASs. And this is because this is a flat rate environment. And so all of the best effort traffic that's allowed through is best effort traffic from the legitimate AS. The graph on the right shows the long-term loss rate. We see that the long-term loss rate for all of the other flows is quite high because they are not being adaptive at all, while the legitimate AS has a very low long-term loss rate because it is adaptive. We also looked at reactive attacks, and these are the same two graphs. The bandwidth allocation is still fair, even though the attack ASs are each sending 300 times as many flows as the legitimate AS. And that's because we're just enforcing the policy of per AS fairness. And because everybody is using reactive protocols here, we're experiencing a similar long-term loss rate for both legitimate ASs and attacking ASs. We also look at premium client support. ASA, which is a premium AS, has a reservation for half of the available bandwidth. Without premium support, the bandwidth is shared evenly among all the senders so that the amount of bandwidth that's available for ASA drops linearly in the number of senders. However, when we do have premium support, this premium AS is able to maintain a high level of bandwidth regardless of the number of other senders. So in conclusion, MiddlePolice combines the immediate deployability of cloud enforcement, per-sender traffic policing of capability systems, and victim-selectable policies, which are not in the literature in either cloud enforcement or capability systems. In order to do so, we've contributed two new mechanisms, one which is an immediately deployable ACL-based bypass filter, and we have a handshake-like sender verification that relies on HTTP's redirect mechanism. Our performance analysis shows that we have relatively low overhead in both hop count and latency, and that we're able to effectively enforce victim-selected policy. Thank you.
So thanks for the talk. Are there any questions? Please.
Yeah, very nice talk. Thank you. Sorry, I'm here. I have two questions. One is a question regarding the deployment. So is the victim at the level of an AS or of an end host? And if so, how do you think, how many of the middle boxes do you need for each victim? So how many do I have to distribute over the world? That would be the first question. The second question is, don't you run into a bootstrap problem because you require active communication between the middle box and the victim?
Okay, so with regards to the first question, the victim, we've always considered the victim at a server level, although of course it could be an AS, and the number of middle boxes that you would need to support, it really is a scaling issue on the amount of state you have to keep and all of that. I don't think that this is much more work than this is not much more work than what the cloud systems currently do, and we're able to support multiple middle boxes per server. So I think that basically the overhead looks like a normal cloud system.
Let me comment on this, but because you need one cloud, because if you do DNS or BGP redirection, you need one cloud.
Oh yeah, but we're not doing...
Exactly, so that's why you need much more middle boxes than clouds, right?
Well, you need much more middle boxes than clouds. I don't see that point. We can talk about that offline. And then the second point of bootstrapping, we make certain assumptions about the ability to pass traffic through against adversarial cross traffic. So you may be familiar with the crossfire attack. We assume that there is some level of cross-traffic management so that the attackers cannot cause an unbounded... traffic that's destined to another AS cannot cause unbounded losses to our AS. And then we can definitely get our initial packets through. This is an assumption, but it can be met with weighted fair queuing and other approaches.
Okay, so maybe you... Can we switch the presentation on the fly during the question, please?